Thank you.
You may be seated. We're gathered here today in memory of our dear friend, brother, uncle, cousin, father, husband, Brother Lawrence Mary Welton Ward. And for the purpose of the recording that is being made for the family and the broadcast is being Zoomed, I will read through the program. Lawrence Mary Welton Ward was born November 12, 1966 in Malad, Idaho. He passed away August 26, 2022 in Oxford, Idaho. This service is being conducted on Saturday, September 3rd, 2022 at 11 a.m. My name is Bishop Lincoln Mumford. I'm conducting. President Hans Smiley, our state president, is presiding here. The pallbearers are his sons, Dallin Ward, Spencer Ward, Enoch Ward, Benjamin Ward, Nathaniel Ward, and Nathan Harris, a missionary companion. Honorary pallbearers are his brothers Lonnie, Lloyd, Leland, Lyle, Lynn, and Lauren Ward. The family prayer was offered by his father, Welton Ward. Our prelude and postlude music is provided today by a friend, Larry Westover. The program will go as follows. Our congregational hymn, number 124, Be Still My Soul, will be our first number. Trudy Ward, his mother, will accompany this, and Erica Ward, his sister-in-law, will be the chorister. Following that, we will have an invocation by Lucy Johnson, Larry's sister. Then the life sketch will be given by Lauren, Lynn, Lyle, Leland, and Lloyd Ward, Larry's brothers. A speaker will then follow them, Brother Lonnie Ward, a brother. Following Lonnie, the musical number will be performed by Enoch Ward, his son, and Alyssa Ward, his daughter-in-law, titled The Savior's Lullaby. Ashley Cox had prepared, but in the last minute change, they changed it, and we appreciate Ashley's preparation. You get full credit, Ashley. But she will not be part of that. Memories will then be given by Nate, Rachel, Becca, Spencer, Dallin, Enoch, and Enoch Ward, his children, and by Jill Ward, his wife. I will then give some remarks. We'll go to that point. Let's start with the congregational hymn. Thank you.
We come before thee this day with so much gratitude for the blessing that we have in each of our lives of Larry. We're so grateful for the positive effect that he shared with so many. We're thankful for his love and his example. We're so thankful for the gospel that we know that we can be with him again. And that this sting of death isn't quite so painful because of that. We ask thee to please bless Larry, as we know he will be a hardworking and valiant missionary on the other side and helping us on this side. Please help us to live up to the example that he showed us and to try a little harder to be a little better each and every day in every single way. We love thee, Father. Say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. He was born on November 11, 1966, in Lyle, Idaho, as the eldest child of Welton and Trudy Ward. He wrote the following in his journal about growing up very young. We, that is my brothers and I, had to milk the cows. That was the messiest job I ever had. We would usually split the milking. My brothers did half and I did half. I had that deal for a couple of years. And then I had to do the feeding. When he was about 7, he was doing the feeding and the haystack fell on top of him. He screamed and screamed for help for several hours. But cousins had come to visit, so it took a long time for them to realize he was missing. His voice was never the same after that. He was always very self-conscious about singing in public because of it. However, there was one exception. It never stopped him from singing Dunderback. Which is a morbid song about an old butcher. I'll let Dad sing that later if he wants. The song has been sung down the generations in our family. It was applauded by the women and laughed about by the men. When Larry was laying in bed, very sick, the last week of his life, we all got a good laugh when we mentioned the song, and he sat up and sang it. Larry wrote, "I can remember playing with neighbor kids, climbing trees, and playing in the creek, or any place that was convenient. They used to call me Onky, because I was always climbing trees.
it was easier then because I was smaller and lighter, and it was easier to go through the branches.
Larry was an avid sports fan. They loved to watch sports with his family, especially like football, which we will be watching later today in his honor. He could always be seen wearing headphones, listening to the game, and he said that Grant or Bell wouldn't know what to do without him. In high school, he lettered in football, wrestling, and track. He received the All-District Honorable Mention Running Back Award in 1984. I claim that the reason he was so good at football is because as a first grader, I'd be trying to get to the bus, and Larry would come along, pick me up under his arm, and run me to the bus. So it got a lot of practice. Because I couldn't go very fast through the snow. Larry wrote, "My favorite sport has always been football because I liked it when I watched it on TV. My first hero was Fran Tarkington of the Minnesota Vikings. I admired the way he would scramble from the defense and elude them. I used to watch every Minnesota Vikings game. I never missed one. Then I would try to be just like him. My friends would come to my house for piano lessons, and then when they finished, we would play football. We would set up a game and have fun playing. After high school, Larry attended Idaho State University and received his certification in auto mechanics. He then worked as an auto mechanic for several years in Las Vegas. While working at Cotton Ford, he had access to some very awesome, fast cars and received a few tickets along the way. He also moonlighted on the side, running his home carpet cleaning business. Later, Larry received a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from BYU. For his senior project, he was part of a team that built and raced a mini Baja car for BYU.
I was glad then to talk a little bit about Larry's sports because when I was in high school, I thought back to and really looked up to Larry for the hard work he put into in sports. And I remember I had a weight bench in my room, and I put a couple of Larry's pictures from high school up on the ceiling to inspire me. At age 25, Larry served a mission for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Serving a mission and teaching others about the gospel plan was a highlight for him. And he continued to be a missionary in every phase of his life. After returning from his mission, he had the opportunity to work at MGC as a teacher for 2 years, which he said was the favorite jobs he ever had. One of Larry's companions wrote the following: "Elder Larry Ward was the greatest missionary and a companion anyone could ever ask for, except for when he kept, I'm trying to wake you up at 5 o'clock instead of 6:30, which was the rule from the White Handbook. I just kept thinking he was a crazy Idaho farm boy. Larry was the hardest working missionary in the entire mission. He was so dedicated to the Lord's work that he sold his thriving and carpet cleaning business, his home, and most of his belongings to serve the mission. Larry was a can-do missionary. There was nothing he couldn't do with the Lord's help. His faith in Christ was total. When kneeling in prayer as companionship, he got a very distinct feeling and witness from the Spirit that those prayers would be answered, and they were. Larry was a leader. He met with Bishop Jack German in the War Council in Wilmington, Delaware, and laid out her goals for the Ward Missionary Plan. Larry challenged the bishop and the Ward Council to help the people help people find people to teach. The bishop was a Vietnam veteran and told us after a few weeks of observing our conduct that he had been waiting 10 years for the right set of missionaries to come along that he could trust to teach his best friend, Joe O'Leary, who was in Vietnam with him. When we met Joe, there was an instant bond with Larry, and Joe was baptized by him. The thing I will always remember most about Larry is his faith in the Lord and his love of his fellow man. His strength and his commitment to his sweet companion, Jill, and their amazing family. Larry was and is a stalwart. I am forever grateful for his friendship and this example. I actually served my mission at the same time as Larry. Our missions overlapped by a year. And Heavenly Father just has a knack of putting people in the right place at the right time. And that was definitely true of Larry. The last girl that I baptized on my mission ended up going out to Utah for school, and she came in contact with Larry, and she was working with Jill, and she thought Larry and Jill would make a great couple, and so she set him up on a date, and the rest is history. But when I told Wendy about Larry's passing, she wrote me back and said, I feel so blessed to have known him, spent time with him, and introduced him and Jill so many years ago. I love knowing that they have forever together. There is such comfort in the plan of our Heavenly Father. My heart aches for you and Jill and their children to lose Larry at such a young age. I will be saying prayers for all of you tonight and throughout this time of both of grieving and celebrating his life and time on earth. He was so full of love and kindness. I understand he will be doing and continuing the great work in heaven. Thank you for letting me know and allowing me to reflect on the memories I spent with Larry.
Larry was always my hero. When I was a little boy, he was always the one I looked up to. In 1993, he called me and he said, I'm going to Ecuador. I want you to go with me. Me and Lloyd, my cousin Richard, are going to go. And I said, Larry, I don't have money. He said, no, you don't understand. I want you to go with me. Larry paid for me to go to Ecuador. I had a special time this day with my aunt, uncle, and cousins. And my brother's cousin. When we got back, he called me He decided to selling my business and going on a mission. Need some help. Can you move down here and live with me for the next 4 months and help me prepare for my mission? He didn't know the time. Larry was. But I was going through a hard time. Wasn't active in the church. I had no desire to be active in the church. But that time with Larry had seen his faith and some of the people that he had touched down there helped change my life and put me back in the path that I need to be in. Larry married his sweetheart, Jill Whitaker, on May 24th, 1997, in the Mount Timpanogos Temple in America. Together, they had 7 children, Dan, Spencer, Enoch, and Becca, Rachel, and May. Speaking of the children, Larry always loved our to youth. He served as coach for baseball, wrestling, football. His most recent church calling was served as first counselor in the Bachelor Ward under Bishop William. He loved his calling so much, especially loved his stewardship of youth. He was really sad that his ability to interact with them was hampered. But he always prayed that he would have a positive impact on their lives. He taught small engines at Spanish Park High School and another shop at Mount High School. Some of the comments we have received from his former students have been, Larry was a huge part of molding into the man, husband, and father I am today. I will forever cherish the time we spent with him and the lessons he taught me. Whether it was on the football field, the classroom, or church, he was one of the best examples of being a good father, of what being a good father really means. And that testifies itself to the men we both have raised. I love him and your family. Your dad definitely has left the world a better place. I'll never get him back. He had on me. When I was at the feed store, I worked at the feed store for him, or when he coached me football. The world needs a long animal like your father. I have so many of his former students, football players, wrestlers coming to me and giving me a hug and telling me how much they impacted me. He was a truly great man. He is watching words. One of the last things he told me is he said, I'll be watching over you.
Larry has always had a great love for his country, the United States of America, and had a great respect for our founding fathers, who sacrificed so much for the freedoms that we enjoy today. He served as a Republican chairman in Oneida County, taught constitutional classes, and taught his children the principles of freedom. In January 2021, he was scheduled to start teaching the principles taught in the 5,000 year league. It's hard to see this when I can't. Should have memorized it, I guess. But his health took a sharp decline. He never was able to teach the class. The original degree that he started working towards at BYU was a law degree in constitutional law. So he also took several classes while at BYU to further his understanding of the Constitution. In 2007, he purchased Anderson Pete and the lab, renamed it Ward PNC. Larry used his genius mechanical skills to refurbish the grain bins on the property that he had that had sat stagnant for several years and added a seed business to the feed store. His latest project has been building an ACE store that will be combined with the feed store and open in spring of 2023. Since Larry's illness, his older boys have very graciously stepped in to carry on their father's work. His greatest accomplishment in this life was that of husband and father. He loved each of his children so much and would do anything to help them succeed. He has been especially mindful of his three children, who have a rare disease called, I'm going to just say AT. And he did everything in his power to help them. Larry will be sorely missed by all who knew him, especially his wife and children. We're so grateful that he's finally free of all the pain and suffering he has endured. And we look forward to being reunited with him after this life. I had the opportunity to spend quite a bit of time with Larry over the past year, and a few weeks ago he asked me, he said, "I'm confused. I've received so many priesthood blessings, and I don't understand. Some of them say that I'll regain my health, and some of them say that I'll be free of pain and receive comfort." He said, "I don't understand. It seems some of them are contradictory." And I said to him that it's really difficult to give a priesthood blessing because it's kind of like we're translating a feeling into words, and the feeling is, it's so hard. There's so much lost in translation, and also a lot of the blessings that are promised to us will happen to us, but not here in mortality. And that seemed to give him some comfort. Larry was a hero to me, and grateful for that time that he and I spent together. I moved to Las Vegas two different times and lived with him, and grateful for that experience.
Brothers and sisters, what an amazing day it is today. Yeah, it's a funeral, but it's a celebration of Larry's life. And what an incredible man he was. In my work, I get to see a lot of what most people would consider poverty. And often when we think of poverty, we think of lack of something, or we think of riches as an abundance of something. And usually we tie that to money. But sitting here today, I think Larry was a very, very rich man. He was blessed with an amazing wife, fantastic children. Siblings weren't too bad. and tremendous parents that set by example the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as I think about Larry, passing over the other side of the veil, I just can't think of what an amazing experience that was when he met his Savior. And he probably at first was thinking, "Man, should have done this, should have done the other." He wasn't perfect. He struggled. We all do. That's what life's all about. We all are given challenges. We all have problems. But Larry hit his head on, and he was amazing man. Who is Larry Ward? Besides Jill and maybe his children, I think I know Larry as well as anyone. I can testify that he is one of the Lord's chosen spirits and fought valiantly here on earth. He was a fierce competitor and fought for what he felt was right. He worked hard and played hard and left no doubt in anyone's mind that he knew his Savior Jesus Christ and loved him fiercely. There are certain events that are etched in my mind when I think of Larry. I want to share a few of them with you to give you a feel of the Larry that I know. I remember Dad racing to the fallen haystack and throwing bales as fast as he could to get to Larry under the pile of bales. The fear of what was under that stack and the relief when we found him carefully protected by bales, landing alongside him and then crosswise over top of him. Let us know that the Lord was looking out for him. A whole book could be written about Corbett's brothers and their influence on this. Lon and Alden, Dave, Kurt, truly Christ-like man and their families. The same. The time that the tractor jackknifed with the baler, with Larry at the wheel crushing Dad between the tractor and the flywheel of the baler, it really shook Larry up. It was tough for him. I remember his torn feet from racing along the paved road to the nearest farmhouse to get help after rolling his cart that threw out the two bachelors, killing one of them. I remember the anguish that he went through as he dealt with the consequences of that action. I'll never forget the time that one of his friends offered me some Jack Daniels whiskey. Larry whirled on him and made it very clear that I did not drink and that offering a drink to me again would cause major physical harm. As I started my first year of college, it was such a relief to have him as a support protector. I knew that he was there for anything that I needed. Larry cared about other people. When Eric and I decided to get married and knew that we would be driving to Chicago, I asked him if he could take a look at our car. He suggested that we swap vehicles for a couple of weeks so that he could give it a thorough checkup. I knew that it was really going above and beyond, but that was Larry. His Ford Ranger was his baby. And for him to swap for our car showed me that I was more important than his most cherished possession. That's a funny anecdote. Larry drove fast from Milan to Vegas, which did not escape the notice of the Utah Highway Patrol. Eric was driving a truck in Orem and was pulled over because the taillight was out. It was a busy time. We were just about to get married. It was finals week at BYU, and she was flustered when the office asked for the registration insurance. So she was visibly upset. She wasn't sure what she was looking for and told the officer that it was her brother-in-law's truck. But eventually, she found a manila envelope that looked like it probably had the papers that he needed, and she handed it over to him, not knowing that it had half a dozen arrest warrants. Apparently, they did not like the fact that he did not pay his speeding tickets. I can imagine that was the joke of the police station for the next little while. Fortunately, the officer gave her a warning and taillight and then said, "You may want to tell your brother-in-law to take care of those warrants." It wasn't until later that she realized the precarious nature of the situation. We laugh about it now as we imagine the officer opening up the envelope and seeing all those warrants and stuff. Larry ended up replacing the transmission in our car, which meant that he let us take his truck to Chicago while he was replacing the transmission. And how much did he let us pay him for the use of his truck and for replacing his transmission? Nothing. That was Larry. By the way, he did take care of all his things and got the warrants cleared before he went on his mission. As he became more active in the church in his mid-20s, he started talking about going on a mission. We were all excited for him. I will never forget the day that he called me and with a very dejected voice explained that they wouldn't let him serve. I knew the mission, how much the mission meant to him, and began to console him. Then he flipped the emotional switch in his voice and excitedly told us that he was going to serve in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He was always wondering this all the time. And he loved his mission, especially the service with Elder Nate Harris. Larry's always been a fighter, often beating the odds. I was in Kenya a year ago in July when I got the news that the doctor had given him 3 months. It was tough, and I was trying to think, man, how are all of us going to survive without him? Well, Larry wasn't satisfied with that prognosis, and neither was Jill. And I can't think of a stronger team when it comes to fighting. That 3 months turned into 13. And many of us just believed that he would keep on going. When I visited Larry about a month ago, I could see that his body was worn out and almost gone, but his spirit was so strong. I was still hopeful that his time was not yet. I've had this important business trip planned for several months to go to Peru and Bolivia. It was the first time for me to get back there since COVID-19. And I was to escort a very important business partner. Then Monday of last week, the day before I was supposed to leave, Jill texted me, let me know that Larry probably wouldn't make it until I got back. I went into full panic mode. I checked with the airline to see what options would be if I changed my flight or I cut my trip short. I talked with my boss and with our business partner, and while everyone was understanding, the business partner said they would not go if I was not there to escort them. Since he was paying for my trip and funds are very short right now for our organization, it would probably mean that I would not get a chance to go to these countries again for a while. Jill, Larrikin, and I prayed about this situation and discussed it at length. We decided that I should go and come home early if I needed to do so. I drove up here and spent Monday evening and Tuesday morning with Larry. We had a wonderful discussion of important things in life, while I massaged what muscles I could find on his emaciated back to help ease the pain. Those were sacred hours, and when I said goodbye, we both knew it would be the last time in his life. As usual, Larry hung on long enough that I was able to complete my work in both countries before returning to celebrate his life, just like him to always put others first. I know this is a celebration of Larry's life, but I can't talk about him without mentioning Jill. I remember when he first talked to us about her, He was so excited and so in love with her. Since then, their love has grown and matured. I've heard him on many occasions in public and private say how much he loves her and relied on her support. They are both strong personalities. Make an understatement there. Which sometimes led to challenges in their marriage. But they stayed strongly committed to their covenants and worked things out. This made their love very deep and eternal. Jill was an angel, and is a major reason why Mary was able to do and be so much. Thank you so much, Jill. And know that we are here to support you. Larry loved music, and it was a way that his passion could find release. Sharing a room with him, I got to listen to his favorite bands and see how it inspired him. For the last couple of weeks, I have used music to strengthen and comfort me. The melody of the song Down the Line by KPM Listening. Has brought me great comfort. And the lyrics speak to me as I think of Larry. Take a stand and commit to the plan, and when it's time, you'll know. Why not go through time? You'll jump down the line. Just trust. I know we'll make it. We'll make it. I testify that there is a plan for each of us. We are here to be tested and tried, to learn and to grow, and to become what our Heavenly Father knows we can become. Larry has been tested and tried, and now has completed his time on the earth. I can imagine how glorious their union was as the Savior wrapped him in his arms and said, "Well done, you made it." In the name of Jesus Christ.
So while they're setting up, I used to get really mad at my dad, or anytime I'd go ask him advice on something, he'd always bring it back to Jesus somehow. Look, Dad, just give me some advice. I don't want to hear about it. I don't want to hear another sermon. But I didn't see then what I can see now, the wisdom he had in always bringing everything back to the Savior. And Leland wasn't the only thing that said, the only person that said no. Last week, my mom, she called me and asked me if I would sing this song for the funeral. This was about 5 days before he passed. I told her no, I can't do that. I can't pull myself together long enough to do that. And my dad called me. And he hasn't, at this point, he hasn't called anyone in months. He called me 3 days before he passed. And he asked me personally to sing this song because it talks about Jesus and his story and what he went through. So bear with me, I hope I didn't get through. But listen closely to the words, because it does tell the story of the Savior, because that's who Dad would want us to be thinking about right now. You'd feel awfully selfish to know that we're talking all about him.
Thank you. this faithful day in the ceremony. If the word that would save us each individually. Faithful night, he felt the fears and pain of all mankind. A man can know, no one can tell, the road he had to climb. And Jesus prayed, Father, please, don't think I can take it. The sins of all the world is far too much to bear. There's another way, please won't you reveal it? Are you listening? Are you even there? I'm so alone, I feel that you've forgotten. You're stunned down here in so much agony. Beg of you, let this cup be taken, but let thy will be done, I'll do it faithfully. La 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 la. Of shame spoke loudly of his faith. He dragged his cross. How could one endure such agony and hate? His mother stood beside the cross and wept as her son died. But before he left with all his strength, looked up to the sky, and Jesus prayed. Father and dear, I pray that you'll forgive them. Don't you see they don't know what they've done? If thou wilt, please turn away thine anger. If only for beloved son, I'm coming home, I'll see you in a minute. I love you, Dad, so long, I love her too. At that he hung his head and went to Father, and the angels from on high sang this to. La 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 la.
In fact, it was my brother, Enix, and That's probably why baseball is probably my second favorite sport. Well, my dad was a great teacher. He taught me to shoot guns, and he got me a gun for my 8th birthday. And I was really happy about that. We always talked about how my dad was always the one who had the dead eye. Yeah. He also taught me how to ride a four-wheeler and drive a ball cap. He'd play board games and card games with him. He liked Sorry, but he did not like the old version because it took way too long. I always liked to read books with him. Some of my favorites to read with him were Fable Even and Track and Watch. We also went to Arizona, where my dad was in Phoenix and was at the Mayo Clinic. Nice thing about this one, he really liked it because you could go outside, out in this garden, and learn about different desert plants. And I took a walk with him around there, and he was really interested in them because he had one and brought it home. He was also one of the best smugglers, besides my mom. I'm really going to miss that. Another funny time is my dad was, we were driving back up a driveway, and when we were like at the base of our hill, I told him to stop, and I told him to let me out. That was in boots, and I raced him up. And I really can't tell who won. So, my dad, I wrote in my journal for the first time when he passed, and I wrote, Dad passed away at 8:40 after a series of hymns with the family. Love you, Dad. So one night I was lying in bed thinking about everything been happening, and the spirit told me that I was supposed to speak at the funeral, so I guess here I am. My dad is my best friend. We have a lot of memories together, including camping, driving, fishing, dredging, gold mining, sledding, hiking, ATV, riding, boating, horsing, riding, working, fixing vehicles, playing games, cleaning, organizing, Girl Scout, getting A&W, and listening to conference, and also dancing together last year in the daddy-daughter dance with my drill team. And sitting in his lap watching sports and westerns. A month or so ago, my brother was talking to my dad and told him a quote he had heard a while back. It goes something like this: the words of the Father speak through his children. So incredibly true. A couple of years ago, my dad was letting me driving home from work. And he mentioned something about going to the neighbor's, but I wanted to go home. So I turned into the driveway and pushed on the gas and to go to our house, but I didn't get the water far enough. So I ended up crashing into our white vinyl fence. I thought that my dad would lose it and get so angry with me, but he ended up just laughing about it. One thing about my dad is he doesn't really have a temper. He loves his children so much. He's an amazing man with so many great attributes. Some memories I have with my dad are watching Western and sports together. I was the manager for the Westside wrestling team all 4 years of my high school career. I love it so much. My dad would try to come to some of them. Sports means so much to me. My dad has taught me about, I'm wearing a blue dress today in honor of my dad. What for BYU, and it's also his better color. He was going to pass. I was lying next to him with my hand in his. I felt so much comfort in knowing where he was going. He also has so much love for the Savior and missionary work. One of my really good friends came home from her mission and gave a missionary for when she got home from her mission. That really inspired me. I told my dad what had happened and his face lit up. And I have decided that I am serving in mission in honor of my father. Just recently I was
talking to my parent. I was in my parent's room. And we were talking, and my dad got so excited and told me he was excited to go to college again. And he was gonna be there every step of the way with me the week previous to his passing. I went to the temple 2 days in a row, and both times I got the comforting answer that it will all be okay. Tonight was the last good night. One night I was up late cleaning and about 1 o'clock my mom asked my dad a question and he didn't respond. I thought that was weird, so I looked over at him and he was in a coma. The next day we all sat together around him as a family and sang hymns. It was real special. I hope one day I can find a man like you. Just know your angel is living life to the fullest for you. Love you, Dad. Gather his rug over there for me.
It was a bad idea to go off the back, I'm already crying. I want to start off by sharing a quick fun with my dad last week or so ago. Those that knew him know that he had a very dry sense of humor. So as we knew he was getting close to passing, we asked him, Dad, do you have anything you want to give to any of us kids? Anything that would be special for us to have? He thought about it, and then a few hours later he said, Spence, I'd like for you to have our diabetic supplies. But with the price the way they are, that's probably the most expensive thing he owns. I want to echo Becca's mention of my dad's patience. I can't tell you how many times my brothers or I did something stupid. So when we bought the business, I was 8, and so I started driving more about the 8. And we damaged pallets, dog food. I know Dallin had a windshield at one point. There are all sorts of things. His response every time is just, oops, we'll get it fixed. I never once felt devalued because of something I had done. In thinking about Dad's life, one of the greatest attributes of his I constantly saw was his raw determination. Anything he thought he should be able to do, he did. Stories of this range from walking home from the hospital the same day he was admitted to the hospital, and loading our mini horse in the back of our Ford Aerostar because we didn't have horse room. One story in particular that's more recent really sticks out to me. It happened around this last December, and so at this point, Dad had kind of been off and on involved with work because of his health, and so he did as much as he possibly could, but he wasn't able to be there a whole lot. And I think at this point, he had kind of gone for a little while, so he was really, really determined to get back in and kind of get some things done in there. And so at this point, he'd been fighting cancer about 6 months, and he had just been through first round of chemo. And during chemo, he fasted because he did better with the side effects. And he decided after fighting cancer for 6 months and chemo and fasting, he was going to come to work. So he and Dallin were working on tearing down part of an old shed that we had. And they had taken all the tent off and down to just the frame. And because it was the easiest and quickest solution, he decided to use the wall frame itself as the platform to stand on. And this is the wall frame he was tearing down.
And those of you who understand physics usually take in part your ladder while you're on it. It's not the brightest idea. But my dad always, he just found a way to make things work that probably shouldn't have worked. So I wasn't there for this part, but according to Alan, he almost fell once. And because you know the frame is like it's just 2x4. So he's standing on a 2x4, holding on to an upright 2x4, and trying to prop the 2x4s above him. So according to Alan, he almost fell once, but he grabbed the pry bar and put the board above him and kind of stabilized himself. Of course, he didn't even rethink the situation. He didn't get safety gear in, and he just went back to work on it. He eventually did fall, and he fractured his heel. And I remember my mom's reaction of him limping into the store, and she said, "Larry, what did you do? You are a stage 4 pancreatic cancer fighter going through chemo. You can't afford to break a bone, too." And so we went and looked at and got a boot for it. And I went into work the next day, and I just kind of figured he was going to take it easy for a few days, you know, recover a little bit. And I go up to the office, and we had a big diesel truck up there. And from the hood of the diesel truck, he was like arm deep in it. And all I see is just his plastic, you know, padded boot just hanging from the edge of the Ford truck. I was like, "Dad, what are you doing here?" I was like, "I gotta go to work." He just never quit in anything that he wanted to do. Didn't matter what the odds were. With all the memories that I have with my dad, the most cherished are those when he taught me. Those who know him know he's not much one for lecturing. I don't remember many long speeches at all that he gave me about anything. He always just taught by example. If he had a catchphrase, I think it would be, "It'll all work out." Anytime I went to him with a problem, big or small, he would always listen carefully, and in one way or another respond with that simple phrase. I really didn't understand the full power of it until he got sick. This period of time left so many unanswered questions about everything we had going on. What would we do to help him get better? How would we keep the business running in the meantime? How would Mom be able to take care of the family? And hardest one of all, what if he didn't get better? On each of these issues, he gave wise counsel, but it always came down to it all work out. His faith in our Father in Heaven continues to stand. Because even on the last day when I was asking, you know, reflections from his life from this last year, and if he was scared to die, and you know, any other issues I had, that was his response, it'll all work out. And the Father understands. He went through a lot in his life, especially the last year. When I got the final news that he only had a week or two, it left me to ponder a lot on what the point of this last year was. He really didn't have much of life. He spent most of the time doing treatments and pacing around in intense pain. The quality of life that he had most of the time made it seem pointless to even try to fight the cancer. What was the point of all that if it only was to end in a much too early death? While many answers have come to me in my pondering and prayer, there's one that is the most powerful. I realized that through his pain, he brought healing. And through his weakness, he brought strength. I watched his relationship with my mom heal as they worked together to fight this cancer. I watched as our family and community grew closer as they rallied around him. I watched my brothers and I grew into men while trying my way adequately to fill his shoes. Most of all, I saw hearts soften and testimony strengthen as he continued to testify to us, even in his jovial moments. I never once heard him question or curse God. I remember a few occasions where my dad wondered about the gift of healing he was promising his VHR lesson. It was a great frustration to him that he has multiple kids with health problems, me being one of them. Yet he couldn't figure out how to use his gift of healing. I believe that promise of healing was at least partially fulfilled this last year. I personally feel much more complete because of the experience that I had this last year. Thanks for that, Ed. Love you.
when you have 5 minutes to talk about your dead dad, what do you say? Something I admire about my dad a lot is that my dad picked up his cross and he bore it. And he bore it with everything he had. And I'll admire until the day I die, and I'll pull strength from the fact that my dad gave everything. He didn't give up. He didn't stop working, and he didn't die until he felt it was okay. And I love him for that forever. The night before my dad died, we didn't know he was going to die. He actually looked really good, all things considered. And so we sat around talking with him. Molly had just totaled their car when she hit a deer, and so it was about midnight. We were sitting around talking about what to do with getting them a new car, and Dad was just sitting there listening and participating a little bit. And as we all kind of settled down to go to bed, he gave my dad a hug, and the last thing he ever told me, he said, "You're a good man. You're a great man. And thank you for everything you've done for me." And I said, "Oh, Dad, I learned from the best." And he didn't say anything. He just pointed to my mom. He loved her. He loved my mom. Thinking about that experience and thinking about my dad and what he would have wanted, I thought about what he'd probably want said if he were here. All of you were important to him. He loved you. And some of you he didn't know very well. I have some friends sitting over here, and he didn't know them very well, but he knew that they loved me. And he loved them because of it. If my dad were here, I think he'd thank all of you for the things that you did for him, for the love that you showed to him, be it through his children or through his siblings, however that would have been. And I think he'd ask God to bless all of you. He'd tell you to go on, to be strong, to have faith, and to look forward to a joyous reunion with God, which will come. And he'll be very happy to see you again. I think that's about it. About my dad. I still love it. Thank you all for coming and for being a part of remembering it.
So President Smalley said it's not normal for the wife to speak at the funeral, but nothing about our story has been normal. So I'm going to skip a whole bunch. First of all, I just want to tell my children what wonderful tributes they paid to their father. Thank you. Dad would have been very proud. And I'd like to thank each of you for coming today to pay tribute to my best friend. Having gained an incredible missionary, patriot, and man, and I am so happy that he is finally free from all of the pain and suffering he has endured for the past 9 years. In Larry's patriarchal blessing, it says he will be called upon to teach both the youth and the elderly, and that he would be called to minister to the people, and that he would be loved by all whom he came in contact with. He was told that love would carry him through many, many trials on this earth, for there would be many, as Lucifer knew of his capabilities and would do all in his power to prevent him from performing those callings. It has been incredible to watch him be loved by all whom he came in contact with. As we have been through the refiner's fire over the past 9 years, specifically the last two, the love of the people has truly been a huge part of what has carried us through the trials, and we are so grateful for that love. After Larry had the nose tube been reinserted for the second time for feeding, we were laying in bed having one of our pillow talk discussions, and Larry commented that he was starting to feel like Job. He had suffered 8 long years from the debilitating disease of pancreatitis, had been diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer, had recently become an insulin-dependent diabetic, and had just had an NJ tube placed once again, something he swore he would never do again. I turned to him and said that I had never wanted to be a nurse either. Just the thought of needles, blood, and body fluids has always made my stomach turn. Nursing was not something I would have ever considered going into, but here we were, both facing some of our biggest fears and learning and growing in ways that we never thought possible. Despite all of the health challenges we have been through, I know that God is good, and we know that He has always been there for us. We have been richly blessed with so much through these experiences and have learned so many lessons, including an incredible amount of patience, the power of prayer, that the Lord is in the details, God is still a God of miracles, and the power of temple covenants. The day after Larry's pancreatic cancer diagnosis, we went to the Welton Temple to perform proxy sealings. It was a very tender moment that I will always remember, taking each other by the hand, kneeling across from the altar from each other, and looking at our reflections in the temple mirrors as we were reminded of the covenants we had made to God and each other 24 years prior. Those covenants took on extra special meaning after the news that we had received the night before. My heart was so comforted that my family had been sealed together forever, and no matter what the outcome of Larry's cancer, everything was going to be okay. Larry loved missionary work so much and really looked forward to the day that we would serve a mission together. Although we did not have the opportunity in a traditional sense, we did have the opportunity to do some missionary work when we went to Hope for Cancer in Mexico together. When we were packing our bags to go to Mexico, I was focused on packing clothes, medications, and figuring out how to pay for everything. Larry asked me if I had any extra Book of Mormons we could bring. I told him no, and the thought hadn't even crossed my mind. He asked me to please go pick up 10 of them so we could bring them. I ended up making a last-minute trip out of town to pick them up. We handed out all of those books and ended up buying more for our return trips. One of my friends from Hope for Cancer is here today with us from Texas, and we are so grateful he could be here with us. He and Larry had an instant bond, and Larry loved him so much. As I knew his time was getting close, he had asked for a blessing or release on a Saturday night. And one of my biggest fears was death and how I would handle that and just how the whole process would happen. And I was just imagining, like, me waking up and finding him there gone and being a mental mess and not being able to function. And the night before he passed away, the bishopric had come to visit, and they left at about 10 o'clock that night. And I think everyone was shocked he passed away the next day, because he was still coherent and talking to us, and it just wasn't a normal passing, but it was so beautiful. And he asked me to drop his meds for him about 12:30, and I did, and I laid down on the couch, and he was in his recliner, and I woke up about 5 to check on him, and I noticed he hadn't taken his meds, so I flipped on the light, and he was sitting in his chair in a coma with his eyes open, and I just had such a spirit of peace that I'm so grateful for. I wasn't hysterical, I wasn't worried, I just was blessed with the spirit of peace that surpasses all understanding. and that Spirit has attended our family for the last week, and I'm so grateful. But I just turned out of hands and just visited with him and kept going through pictures I was working on. And we just had a special final hour together. I just think what a tender mercy that was. And then I eventually got down in there about 6 o'clock, and we spent about another hour with him, and then we thought we probably should call the kids in, and we just sang hymns, and it was such a peaceful passing, and all of our hearts were just filled with gratitude and love, and it was just beautiful, so much more amazing than I could have imagined, and I just felt so happy that Larry could finally be released from the pain and suffering he's endured for so long. I love you, Larry, and I look forward to when we will be reunited again. And I also look forward to meeting my Savior again as well. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Supposed to go, so I apologize. I won't take much of your time, but for the past year, I've been recording conversations with my dad. He didn't know. I wanted to make a final tribute to him, and I wrote him a song, and I was just going to share it with him. I shared it with him last week, shortly before everything. Shortly before he passed, but he also requested that I just play it for you. It's just a recording, and he'll get to tell you a little bit about who he is and who he was and is. So, with that being said,
past year? Did you change anything about the past year? Probably not. As strange as that is to say. And what I like to go through, all that pain and agony, and suffering again, and going on. But it had a little more for me. That's very, very said diligence isn't about, you know, sprinting down the track and everything's great. It's more about just that daily effort. Whether it's good times or bad times, and no matter what the circumstance, just keep moving forward. And that's kind of the model for my life. It's kind of what I made myself. Is it diligent? Just I'm trying not to get discouraged. I mean, I get a lot of discouragement times, but not for my brain, rest, or anything like that. Because
do you remember the long ago? You used to tell us life is a hard road. Do you remember the times we shared? I remember that it ain't fair. I was there for the phone call. Mama cried. You put on a tough face and said, I'm not afraid tonight. I started to walk away. Couldn't hold my tears. When the doctor said, you have less than a year. Heaven called you early, and I don't know why, but I know you tell me, trust in God and don't cry. Just let go of the pain, take to heaven and fly. Sure gonna miss you, Dad. I'll see you on the other side.
God, you are here. I'm just going to be here. You're so welcome.
It struck me today, as I listened to these talks, that is there a more appropriate mission for someone who loved his fellow man, loved this country than Philadelphia, for a mission? last fall, as Larry was serving faithfully as our first counselor in our bishopric, he opened the testimony portion of the meeting by sharing an excerpt from the patriarchal blessing that Jill referred to. He shared that you will be loved by many, and that love will carry you through many, many trials you'll experience on this earth. He then testified of its fulfillment in his life. And as I view this audience today, I testify the reality of that prophecy continues. And by virtue of the sealing keys and temple cabinets made in cap, that love for Larry will continue to carry and live Jill and each of their posterity. Jill, we mourn with you and recognize your fierce devotion to Larry and your family. So often Larry would express profound gratitude for the selfless commitment which Jill had for him through his many hospitalizations. In private and publicly, he recognized how she was so willingly in his corner, and how often when pain would almost debilitate him, she was there to be his voice. Jill, we acknowledge and honor you for this Christ-like attribute and advocacy. Your determination and grit is worthy of emulation, and we love you and your family as well. In that same meeting, Larry shared a quote from Elder Jeffrey R. Holland, the Latter-day Apostle. Quote, the first great commandment of all eternity is to love God with all our heart, mind, and strength. But the first great truth of all eternity is that God loves us with all his heart, mind, and strength. I submit if we were to poll the audience today, we gather innumerable anecdotes and experiences where there is show love and charity to his neighbor. One of the many memories I'll cherish of Larry has to do with him at high school wrestling matches. In about every wrestling match I attended where Larry was there, yes, he did have a seat in the stands, but you wouldn't find him there, if ever. Instead, a familiar sight became one of Larry with his arm around the somewhat slumped shoulders of a wrestler, usually one who had just been beaten by a pin or fall, except for Enoch. He didn't lose much. But if you were close enough to him, you could hear him give offer gentle words of encouragement or technical advice or both. He just loved and cared enough about that individual to do what he could to build him up and express confidence in him that the defeat was not permanent. Larry's belief in them was patterned after our Savior's belief in us, who loved us enough to demonstrate and enable us that no defeat is ever permanent, and victory over our old self always results when we love God and seek improvement. Truly, our motives do matter, and to Larry, love of God and neighbor mattered a great deal. In another testimony meeting, this only days after the news of his diagnosis of stage 4, Larry expressed that even in the face of it all, he felt peace. He expressed his willingness to bend to God's will on either side of the veil of mortality. How can someone receive such news so calmly except with an abiding faith in the Godhead? Though he did not ask for it, Larry submitted to the plan for him, it included much adversity. He expressed repeatedly to me of desiring, and I believe possessing, the faith to be healed and the faith not to be healed, and to accept God's will for him. One of Larry's favorite apostles, Neil Maxwell, taught, quote, "The great challenge is to refuse to let the bad things that happen to us do bad things to us. That is the crucial difference between adversity and tragedy." End of quote. Larry's pancreatic fight was well known, as equally as it was courageous. And make no mistake, he left this life swinging. His wrestler tenacity was evident. But in another public testimony, he explained that adversity is not all bad if we approach it with faith and an eternal perspective. He also shared counsel that when we face adversity, we have a choice. Either to just go through it or to allow the adversity to go through us. He loved that when we accept the adversity to go through us, we change, we're molded. Larry died great and Larry lived great, looking to use adversity as an avenue to become who God wanted him to become and accept God's will and timing. In the scripture that says, "For the natural man is an enemy to God, will be forever and ever, unless he yields to the enticements of the Holy Spirit, and becometh as a child, submissive, meek, humble, patient, full of love, and willing to submit to all things which the Lord sees fit to inflict upon him, even as a child does submit to his father." To Larry, faith in Godhead mattered. Regardless of the outcome, he did not shrink. To Larry, eternity mattered, and that spiritual perspective moved him to testify that the Holy Ghost does not deal in despair, but he deals in light, hope, and optimism. Larry never quit loving, never quit trying, and he never quit growing. In what would become my final interaction with him, on the night before he passed, we as a bishopric, as was mentioned, visited him in his home. We shared several tender memories and minutes with him then. At this point, his passing had become pretty much acknowledged as being imminent, though none of us thought it would be that night, or less than 12 hours later. And he was looking forward to a future free from his mortal body, now wrapped with disease and pain. He faced death at the exact same level of otherworldly faith and courage, which had sustained him in his prolonged fight to live. Indeed, there was light, there was hope, there was optimism, all of which were evidence to us that a spiritual giant was yet among us. As we departed that night, he struggled to stand, and we embraced. I told him that I loved him, then turned to go. I got to the entryway of the living room, but turned back toward Larry, who had already returned to his chair. With a smile, I gave him a somewhat muted cheer, "Hurrah for Israel," to which he responded loudly, and with his right arm thrust into the end, "Hurrah for Israel!" This volume and the spirited motion surprised me. I didn't think he had the strength for it. It reminded me of the man I knew whose testimony burned as bright as the gratitude and the God for the gospel that he believed and loved with all his heart, mind, and strength. And Larry always loved that cheer. Only hours later, he graduated from mortality, but I'm certain he departed this life full of hope. You see, "Hurrah for Israel" was a cheer given by Brigham Young and Heber Kimball to their families as they departed for their missions in Great Britain in the early days of the church. With it, they hoped to leave their family a rallying cry to live and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. This will forever be a choice memory to me, and I share it with his posterity in the hope that it will be a rallying cry for them and for you and I to continue living and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you are a son or a daughter, sister, brother, cousin, wife, or friend, I think I've included about everyone this way, he left us a standard to live by and to strive for, to view our adversity through the lens of eternity. Perspective matters, that our faith should not be based on outcomes. Submission to God's will matters most. And finally, that our primary motivation to obedience should be the first and second great commandments, to love God, to love our neighbor. Our supreme goals, love is our motive, matters the most of all. Hurrah for Larry's life well lived. Hurrah that his spirit lives on and will be reunited with his perfect body someday. Hurrah for eternal covenants that bind Larry to his family forever. And it's all possible because of Jesus Christ's atonement, the reality of which I testify is true in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Presidents, maybe we'll make a comment, and then we will have the closing congregational hymn, number 152, "God Be With You Till We Meet Again," the first verse, after which the benediction will be offered by Lorraine Spencer, his sister, the dedication of the grave, which will be in Oxford, Idaho Cemetery, will be performed by Welton Ward, his son. And we'd like to thank the Oxford Ward Relief Society for the compassionate service they provided, and invite all who've been invited this family to return to the church for lunch. President Smith.
I witness this day that Jesus Christ is pleased with the life of Larry Ward. I also witness of an experience I had the last time I saw him, where the Lord made it known to me that Larry is worthy and that his service has been accepted in mortality. I testify to each of us here today that it is because of Jesus Christ that we will see him again. We will all see him again. To Jill, to the children, I love your family. To his siblings, I can tell you're his siblings. And you're awesome. I testify of the reality of this gospel and of the plan of salvation. It's real. Jesus Christ lives. He loves us. And because of him, we can be always together. My sister Ward, I testify to you that the temple covenants you made were real, and they've never been more important than now. And know that they're real, and the comfort we get from that, and I'm grateful for that.
If I had time, I would mention some few more things, but I know the time is short. But let it suffice that I testify that the area was worthy and that I had a wonderful experience with the Savior in that regard. I'm grateful for his example. I only knew him for about a year and a half, and he changed my life because of his faith and the devotion he had to his family and to his God. I will never forget Larry Ward, as I know the rest of us will not either. And I thank Heavenly Father for him. I leave my witness with each of us here today that God lives and that he loves us, and that we will see our dear friend again. And I say that in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Example and Larry's example. two of the best big brothers anybody could have. We pray that we will go forward this day with that determination in our hearts, minds, and that everybody will go forward with safety and peace, knowing my plan. We're so grateful for that plan, Father, that we'll be able to see him again, and that we know that he is going to be watching over us, and that he'll be with us. And we'll see him again. And we love thee, Father, and we say these things in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, thank you for your attendance. Will the audience please arise?
I'd like to invite Paul Bishop. You'll step just out here, please.
Cemetery for prayer, you're welcome to at this point. This meeting stands adjourned. Thank you.